Hachette Audio presents The Detective's Assistant, written by Kate Hannigan, read by Christine Lakin. Dedication for Norm. We never sleep. Chapter 1, in which I find myself on the doorstep of a pickled onion. "You're expecting me to do what?" snapped a peevish voice from the other side of the heavy wooden door. It opened just a few inches to allow a single blue eye to survey me up and down. "Take in this gangly urchin you claim is one of my kin. One look tells me the child hasn't made the acquaintance of a bar of lye in a good many years, not to mention been in the same 2-mile vicinity of a comb." I quickly ran my hands over my head to smooth down my hair from the center, lest she start commenting on the size of my ears.
"Why, yes, Mrs. Warne,"
said the Right Reverend, sliding his pointy black boot forward just a hint to keep her door from slamming shut on his petition.
"You are the waif's last relation in the world. Without you, the child is destined to a most piteous life in the orphan asylum."
"Surely someone will come and take the
girl,"
the Right Reverend declared, giving his throat a good clearing. Could she not tell that for herself? I studied her eye through the crack in the door just to see if the woman was wearing spectacles. Surely her vision was failing, because I was obviously not some stinky schoolboy standing here before her. My clothes might have looked a bit on the masculine side, what with having to take my brother's best traveling coat for the long journey to Chicago. And the brown trousers might not be something you see every day on a fancy city girl. But what chores could a body get done on a farm while wearing a dress, I'd like to know. My aunt stared back at me through the inch or so of open door, inspecting me like I was a sack of mealy flour. Then she added, without the least bit of conviction, "She'll make someone a lovely daughter someday." I decided to win her over with my charm, so I smiled up at her with a powerful grin that showed all my teeth. I squeezed one cheek with my finger and forced a dimple. She was the last living relative I had in this world, and I was not going to let her turn me away. My aunt recoiled like I'd just presented her with a toad, pinching her lips so tight they made a straight line across the lower part of her face, or what I could see of her face. I gave it another try. I licked both my hands and ran them through my shortish hair, slicking down any clumps that were sticking up. Then I batted my long eyelashes at her like a graceful doe. I was going for irresistible, but I might have fallen short.
"What's the matter with her eyes?"
The Right Reverend draped his arm around my shoulder, pretending to appear fatherly, but his skinny fingers pinched my shoulder something awful. I got the hint and quickly stopped my eye batting. I returned to hair slicking. He let out a sigh that was about as deep and long as the whistle on our locomotive. I could tell that the Right Reverend wasn't about to head back to the middle of New York State with me in tow. After our long ride down from Chemung County, him and me had spent enough quality time together to last a lifetime. Besides, that man could smell a sucker from 50 paces away, and he wasn't going to give up easily. He had followed the trail to my aunt's door like a coonhound on the hunt.
"Between you and me and the gaslights, Mrs. Warne," he said, dabbing at a faint layer of nervous sweat that had formed above his lip, "the older mites at the orphanage do not have the same appeal as the babies. I don't share this dreadful perspective, mind you, but as a girl of 10 summers, dear Cornelia here doesn't stand a chance of ever getting adopted."
11. I announced, though nobody had seen fit to ask me. Or thereabouts. And then, acting like I'd just spontaneously caught fire, the Right Reverend snatched his hand off my shoulder, pressed some papers in my aunt's direction, and took off down the boarding house stairs. She called for him to stop, but he did not. I stared down the hallway after him, wondering if I should feel a pang of worry. But I couldn't muster even a faint hiccup of remorse to see the backside of that man.
My aunt's entire head was outside the door now, but her body still blocked me from coming into her room. Her face was average-looking, though it could have been pretty if it weren't lined with so much crankiness. I had always envied cornflower blue eyes like hers, and the lashes framing them were long and brown like feathers on a whippoorwill. So pinched and prim like she was, I could tell she was on a fast road to becoming a dowdy old matron. I hadn't seen enough of her teeth to be sure, but I figured her age to be already about 25. I picked up the yellowish papers off the floor and held them out for her to take. She just stared at me and made no motion to invite me inside. "How did you find me?" she asked. Her expression was sour, with a hint of bitterness, and I was immediately reminded of a pickled onion. Her mouth was pinched so tight again, I half expected her jaw to squeak when she moved it. "Right Reverend found you, ma'am. Not me."
"I haven't spoken to anyone in your family since
the accident," I said, filling in the gap. "And Warrens are your family too, by the way." She scoffed and gave me a hard look. I could tell she was sizing me up, so I gave her a hard look right back.
"Accident?"
She laughed, though the sound that came out of her was anything but joyful.
"Is that what they're calling it?"
"There's no they calling it anything," I corrected, a little peevishness coloring the edges of my voice now, too. "There's just me. Ain't no Warrens left in Shemung County except me. I'm the very last one."
"Your mother?"
Whooping cough.
"Uncle Silas?"
Drowned.
"And Martha?"
Scalded.
"Your brothers?"
"One of scarlet fever."
"The other?"
"Fell off the roof last December. Died the next week." She made a little noise, as if that satisfied her. But her eyes didn't go soft or anything like she understood the heavy sack of sorrows I was carrying around. She just kept staring at me until I finally had to look away. My eyes were beginning to sting. I blinked real fast, but not so I'd look irresistible this time. It was because I missed everybody so much. If any one of them was still back at the farm, filling his or her lungs with deep breaths of fresh air, then I wouldn't have to be standing here right now. But with each passing, my world got smaller and smaller, until they were all gone. And here I was in Chicago, alone. My eyes were wet as I picked at my fingernails.
"And your father was the very last to go," my aunt said, with a little sound.
"Cornelius always did look after Cornelius.
Tell me, how did he meet his maker? Hanged from a lawman's noose, I assume?"
"Shot. But he wasn't doing no wrong. He was helping people," I said, then added softly, "Some bad men shot him dead. It was a crime." She went silent, and I was thankful she didn't make hay about my daddy getting himself killed. I didn't know all the particulars of how it happened, but my heart told me he was pure and true.
"It was not your daddy's fault, you say?"
Her voice came so low, I had to lean forward against the dark doorframe a bit so I'd catch it.
"Just like the day he killed my Matthew, his own brother, in what you call an accident."
"Exactly," I said, trying to match my voice to hers, low and serious. She was a pickled onion, and I wasn't about to let her intimidate me. "If you'd let me explain it, you'd understand. My daddy wouldn't never hurt a fly. He didn't mean to kill your Matthew, Aunt Kitty."
"Don't call me that,"
she snapped, stepping aside and finally allowing me to leave the dismal hallway and enter her room. Her dark blue skirts rustled as she walked, and her movements were quick. I noticed she was more slender than I thought she'd be, and taller, too. I looked all around the room. It wasn't the worst boarding house I'd seen in Chicago, but then again, I'd been in town only one day. A boiled cabbage smell hung in the air downstairs in the parlor, but up here on the third floor, it wasn't so bad. Just stuffy and hot. The sound of a horse's shrill whinny on the street below drifted in through an open window, but no breeze.
"I'm not in Shemung County anymore, Cornelia. Here in Chicago, I go by Kate."
"Well, don't go calling me Cornelia," I countered, pushing a lock.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.